My next guest says that Europe's COVID lockdowns are not only hurting Europe's economy, but also hurting the chances of those invested in the S&P 500. He is Kim Iskian. He is the international editor at Stansberry Research, and he joins me live from Ireland now, where you've been under lockdown for a couple of weeks, right?
That's right, Jessica. We have a six-week lockdown that is scheduled to end on December 2nd. Looking forward to it.
Yeah. I understand Goldman Sachs is predicting about a 2.3% reduction, sort of a shrinking of the EU area's economy. What does that look like in your personal experience when you look outside your window and just in your day-to-day life?
Well, here in Ireland, and every EU country has its own own regime. But yeah, we're not supposed to go beyond a 5-kilometer radius. All non-essential businesses are closed. Schools are open, but it is really pretty quiet.
Now, one thing that's different this time with this series of lockdowns across Europe is that manufacturing is continuing, hospitals are open. I think you mentioned schools are open, your kids are still able to go to school. And so there is a little bit of foot traffic on the tram, but how does that play into which sectors are most likely to be impacted economically across Europe?
Well, I think for starters, certainly tourism has been one of the biggest sectors that's been hit hard. Hospitality, food and beverage, just because no one's eating out anywhere. Manufacturing is probably less affected than it would have been otherwise. In Ireland, Ireland is actually looking like it's going to come out of the out of this dip relatively well, because it does have a lot of income from multinationals that have a lot of operations here, and also from pharmaceutical companies that have a lot of operations here. So I think, you know, we can extrapolate and globally certainly see that those are going to be sectors that are going to be less affected.
Yeah, you know, over the weekend I was reading an article about that the fact that a lot of major stocks traded on the S&P really did have a fairly decent recovery in the last quarter, in part because of business in China. Marriott, for example, some of the hospitality stocks are actually seeing a surge of traveling again. But it looks to be going in the opposite direction across Europe. How does that play into people's investments in those stocks? Can Asia really offset the losses in Europe and the Americas if we have the opposite sort of set of circumstances with respect to the virus?
Well, probably to some degree, you'd hope. But, you know, China is doing well. But when I left Singapore, Singapore was just a few months ago, Singapore was still very much closed down. You couldn't travel anywhere. I think that no matter what, earnings for just across the board are going to come down a lot. But it will be a question of looking sector by sector and company by company to see where the biggest exposures are to certainly Europe. Europe is one of the worst affected around the world compared to Asia.
What's the state of play for relief packages? Because I've seen a number of countries propose, Germany, Italy, France, relief packages. I'm not exactly sure whether these are direct stimulus to people or some sort of tax break, but can you tell us where those stand and how likely those are to potentially prevent Europe from going into a double dip recession?
I don't think it'll prevent anything, but it'll just soften the blow. And yeah, here in the EU, for the most part, these sorts of packages have gone to employers to help employers not lay off employees. Whereas in the US, a lot of the money has gone directly to individuals as well as to employers. A lot of EU countries are constrained by fiscal discipline that comes down from the EU. So they can't write checks quite like the Fed can and just, you know, essentially have almost unlimited stimulus. So there's a lot more domestic restraint. But on the other hand, of course, politicians realize that the more money they can hand out, the more likely it is that they're going to be reelected. So you have those two opposing pressures. But I think what we've seen in Europe overall is probably a lot less than what you've seen in the US in terms of overall stimulus.
And lastly, you know, we've gotten at the beginning of the week, we saw a lot of really promising news with respect to the Pfizer vaccine, 90% effective. I know that there are efforts underway by the Europeans to come up with their own vaccines, but also to purchase the most successful vaccine. In fact, I think that the German health minister just said Germany is going to buy the Pfizer and BioNTech vaccine as soon as it is available. What sort of what's the timeline, do you think, for normalcy to return to Europe and thus to all of the stocks that depend on that normalcy, whether it's Coca-Cola or an airline stock?
You know, I don't know. I know as much as the next person about the actual dynamics of vaccines and how they're distributed and made, but it seems to me that all that will be priced in far, far before it's reality. So you probably see a certain lag of people actually being able to get the vaccine and go out and do things normally. But we've already seen, you know, a huge rally in the S&P 500 in 2 days, just on the back of expectation that that day will, well, now we know when that day will more likely come, right? Because yeah. For a long time it's been, yeah, a vaccine, I hope someday. And it's been sort of a specter in the distance. Now it seems a little bit more concrete. Okay, this is a vaccine that works. I can only imagine it'll be many months before that actually comes to pass for normal people like us, though.
All right, Kim Iskian there, coming to us from Ireland. We thank you for your time. Thanks for coming in.
Thanks, Jessica.
You can also find us on YouTube, Instagram, LinkedIn, and Twitter. Thanks for watching. I'm Jessica Stone.